this evening's little lecture. As you all might know, might have read that Sliver this year is focusing on the topic digital craft, and you might all have specific ideas of what that is. The subtitle of the series is called Fabricating the Virtual in the 21st Century, and you will all be aware that what has happened during the last 15 years was basically how do we get the documents from our screen out into reality. And the question that is related also to it is what drives architecture at the moment, and what is architectural expertise? Because if I ask you as an audience, you will all give me different answers of what architecture is, and at the moment I guess nobody really knows what that is. So there is a certain kind of gravitating towards disciplines that support architecture. Disciplines that define things, what architecture should do, what it should come up with, sciences that talk about emotional effects or social programs, but what architecture is as a center of expertise is a little bit in the dark at the moment. This is a situation that is not totally new, and if you know the architectural history of the 19th century, when the first industrial revolution took hold, over the progress in society, architects faced a similar situation. It then was the engineers who were by far more progressive. This is at least what the audience thought happened, and the architectural were kind of second-rate decorators that did facades, whereas behind the facade the real progress was happening. And when you look at the 20th century, you have a history of paradigmatic disciplines that go from, let's say, sociology to biology and constructive or material sciences that again are the fields where the inspiration for architecture comes from, mainly. So the program or the lecture series tries to invite practitioners that operate either in the field of architecture or in neighboring fields, and of course the best specimens are those who operate in both fields. And today we have Michael Hansmeier, who by his history is a kind of hybrid, because he holds a Master of Business Administration from the most prestigious school there is in Europe, that is the school in Fontainebleau. And he has a Master of Architecture from Columbia University. So by itself, he's somebody who is versed in two logics that you would say might be mutually exclusive. At least they are something at odds with each other. And you will see, when he's talking about what he's doing, that this is a no-nonsense approach to architecture that is very much driven by process, and who, as I had the opportunity to talk to him this afternoon, who is able to sketch the space in which architects formally operate at the moment on the basis of the technology that is printing, which is the paradigm that has been with us for the last, let's say, 5 years, and will stay with us for some time. And he's telling you what that really means for the production of architecture. Welcome.
Thank you very much for this introduction and for the invitation. I'm delighted to be here, but from an admittedly very external perspective, it seems like one of the most exciting places in Europe for architecture. I'm going to do this. I've actually made two projects, and both of them are computational design, and both of them do deal with fabrication, digital fabrication. To me, these are the two core technologies that are happening right now in architecture. And I would like to talk about what kind of impact they could eventually have. I'll give one glimpse, certainly not an exclusive one, certainly not a comprehensive one, of what these two technological advances together may bring. And at the basis of both projects is the question in one of your office, what is the origin of form? And to me, related to that is what could be designed, whether by a computer or in any way, if we could drop our references, our bias, our preconceptions, in other words, if we could unlearn everything. So it's about the quest for newness, it's about exploration, it's about discovery. This reference screen, this newness is an aspiration for me, it's a largely unfulfilled one for now. But the idea that I used is I start with some immersive process. I start with a square. And I basically, this process that you see here that was part of pretty much all the projects that I have been doing in the past 5 or 6 years. It's a process of subdividing, of taking a square, of taking a surface, and gradually refining it by dividing it. It's very simple. It just takes one and makes a cross that it divides into more, and you can repeat this over and over again. By this repetition, it's very conducive to the computational approach to computing. Of course, computers are very good at computing stuff. It's a very open-ended process, and it's one that I think is very unprescriptive. And with such a simple process, you can already create an astounding breadth and depth of output. It is. Because you're driving a process to generate a form as opposed to drawing the form itself, and you can simply rerun this process again to produce permutations and variation. And I do this, this was already in the computer. Today, almost everything is in the computer. It's a very transparent job in the computer. But creating something into the computer has a lot of advantages, I find. Not only can you do stuff a lot quicker, you can use the speed to produce more variations, but also to create detail. So the analog of the square is cube. And then by applying the same process to a cube, and just repeating it several times, this cube will turn into, for instance, into this. Or it will turn into this. Or this. Or this. And what is essentially, just as in the previous process that I showed here, there is really control over the form by changing the division ratios. But each form that I'm showing here is essentially, and this one shows it the most clearly, is essentially the cube. This work was recently shown in an exhibition called Naturalizing Architecture in France. And the question that I asked myself was, is this process mimicking nature? Are we mimicking natural processes? Or are we playing it simply a geometrical game of forms? And the more I think about it, the more I get, I think we are. It's more about it's not about using the process to replicate nature, it's more about seeing what is the nature of the process. So a few years ago, I said this living form could be related to the vision of a cell, to morphogenesis, but I think this analogy only has hindsight. I think it has only limited hindsight. It's a facile and perhaps somewhat naive analogy. understanding of what is actually happening in this artificial. But I do know that there's a lot of information contained in these cells already, so it's certainly not reference free. And the idea of dividing, just like adding and subtracting, is so basic that in itself it's an interesting question is how do you divide, how do you add, how do you subtract? And what are the rules according to which you do so? What can use the same process to just sort of spatially differentiate the form? By simply applying.
Can you speak up a little bit? Or
yes, of course. By simply applying different division ratios at different parts of the form. One can position these different division ratios in space, and if one moves the form through the space, how close it is to one, it will start to adapt. So one can create a sort of an artificial context for it. And you can, in doing so, allows you to use local conditions and expands the scope of form. So you can begin to use it sculpturally, I find. And effectively, one is entirely virtual now, so one is free of physical constraints. You can create impossibly small surfaces at impossible angles, which are self-intersecting, that you would never be able to create, or it would be very difficult to create in the actual physical world. But beyond freeing ourselves of these physical constraints, one can also begin to use them playfully. So why not introduce synthetic materiality, to introduce the tearing, a material that starts to generate a porosity when it's stretched too much. And all of these exercises in this virtual laboratory you can use to expand the scope of forms that are conceivable with what is a very simple process. How are these figures interpreted and described? I think geometric descriptions are difficult. And most people resort to figurative ones, natural ones, such as underwater creatures, and man-made ones. I hear the rope, I hear the dolphin, I hear the alien, that's man-made. It's something I'll come back to in a second. But just to once again show you how the process works, essentially, there's two folding ratios. You're seeing them change, and the form is changing correspondingly. The rotation is just apple. You can see the form from on the one side. It's not entirely true, what I've been showing. Most folding ratios produce points. And the forms that I've showed you before actually require an almost endless amount of tiresome experimentation. I found that far more effective way to generate forms that I find appealing is to use information that's already embedded inside the form. And this is a way in this book I was trying to show. It's an attempt to further bring myself out of the process. So I no longer want to be the one that's setting division ratio. I'd like to remove myself as much as possible. It's naive, I know, but the wish is still there. So if you take a form such as this one, there's information inside that you can accentuate that may not be evident initially. So for instance, when you mark the length of the edges and make the long ones white and the short ones black, or when you plot how planar the individual surfaces are, the same thing, the ones that are planar, so four points on the surface, white, the curvature plot, the radiality plot. And when one uses this information, and there's many other topographical and topological attributes that one can take out of this, to actually drive how the form develops, when you can instrumentalize this information, you can articulate it. And in doing so, one actually sets up one rule, one says, if a surface is planar, it's divided like this. If it is very round, it gets divided like this. The interesting effect is that each surface now gets divided individually. So each surface now has its own specific division parameter as opposed to one parameter being divided to one. And I would say the forms, to me, they look slightly more process to generate objects and not when it's designing an object directly, one can rerun the process with different parameters to create permutations. It's the same operation, it's just a slightly different way that's been applied. But I want to stress that no matter how ornamental the form is for you, the process at the heart of it is very minimal. It's always a simple input, QE, arguably one of the simplest forms, and it's a simple operation, dividing or subdividing. So I see it as rather minimalistic. I asked myself, how could one bring this to architecture, at what scale? And I came up with a column, as much of practical, of pure practicality, because that's an architectural object that is still manageable in terms of scale. But also because columns, at least for the Greeks and Romans, had importance because they were very much generated according to explicit rules. A column orders those. If you look back at Vitruvius, it's interesting because it's they weren't yet really illustrations, but it was a text-based description of take a column which is 7 units high, and the bottom unit gets divided into 8 further units, and these get divided into further and further ones. So it was almost as if there was an algorithm to say how these columns are generated. It's only later that the architects began to communicate with drawings and with measurements. So something that was appealing to me. The variations that you saw at that time were actually produced by the craftsmen. So it was the Vitruvius layout given the description that within this, the craftsmen were able to create a lot of variations. And in a way, I see it very well, because one can give a description to the computer, and within it, if I am the craftsman, create a certain amount of variation. So it is. To me, it's about, and I'll show them in a second, it's not about so much about how to combine geometric proportions, but there's nonetheless an order that says how surfaces are arranged in relationship to one another. Instead of the cube, I started with the cylinder, and after many trials, they evolved into this. And they contain information on many scales. This is one thing that's very appealing to me about this. Algorithm approach, that one can use one process, a single process, to create information, to create both the overall form and the microscopic surface structure. So it's very unlike traditional architecture in that sense, where we have one process that creates the layout of the house, the second one that creates some detail with the rooms, and the third one that creates the ornament. One analogy that may be useful is to think of it as designed using synthetic particles or fragments. And it doesn't matter whether one sees them as voxels or as polygons. What we can get due to this computational power is an almost endless resolution, a hyper resolution, an endless scale. It's really only limited by how powerful your computer is. This is 4 years old. Would already go significantly further. I would argue that these forms are undrawable using conventional means. So whether you use a pen or a paper or a mouse, it would take you a long time. They're purely algorithmic artifacts, as I see that. And more interesting question, what my wife plays looks like a roasting chicken, is are these forms imaginable? The process is deterministic all the time, so there's no randomness involved. But there are too many steps for them to be entirely predictable. So I can't
exactly predict what this form is going to look like or what this form is going to look like.
So it's a slightly different role for the architect. One loses control over an exact geometry, but assumes control over attributes. And surprise, at least to me, is not unintentional, but very well known. It's what I spend a lot of time doing actually is trying to see what this process is set up, is how to go through the possibility space. So this process, when I showed it's so open-ended. There's so many possibilities. It's not limited to the aesthetic that you see right here or the one before. A lot of the time is just trying to go through and see what could be possible. And to do so, I really just to bring back the analogy of the lab. It's very much about experimenting and trying out synthesizing. It's perhaps here the analogy to nature, which a lot of people want to presume is actually fruitful. Because in fact, one cultivates in many areas. It's almost like one is a gardener who's breeding permutations, generations, crossing them to new generations, two columns combined to have children, and so on. The architect is an orchestrator. It's an architecture and imagination. The question of authorship often comes up. Mario speaks about this. Is the architect now the one that writes the software, or is he the one that applies it, or does he necessarily need to do both? What must the architect be? What is the architect if he is actually writing these processes? I am very pragmatic. I said today already, I think whatever works. I think you certainly have more leverage if you do both. You can have more control even if you use it to generate surprise. At some point I wanted to move, and this goes to the core of the lecture theme, from the virtual to the physical. And the question came up, how can one materialize these? How can one bring an art into it? In 2010, 3D printing is not where it is. And the only way that I could think of getting it out was as a layered model. What you're looking at here is you're looking at actually 2,700 layers that were then eventually laser cut in what was a very cumbersome process. So this virtual form is sliced up at different intervals. And I was very surprised to see that the intersections look like this. There was a lot of stuff happening inside the column, which we weren't able to see because with our rendering software, you only always see the outside. And the surfaces have in fact continued to divide themselves inside the column, not only on the exterior shell. So from there, we wrote the program to calculate the cutting lines. At that point, Rhino wasn't able to do that without crunching. And from there, we started the laser cutting. 1 millimeter thin cardboard, simply stacked on top of each other. And this now is a photo of another rendering. This was the first set at ETH. And the column ended up looking remarkably similar to the one that was inside our computer. Most of the surfaces were preserved with some limitations. This is the negative. This is the, this is the interior. So it's the leftover, it's the sheets, that everything, the leftovers of the sheets that the column was cut out of. And you can very much see the limitations of the process. So over here, there's a tear that occurs, there's and there's tearing, there's warping that takes place. And especially on the inside, this is without painting, you can see very much the traces of the manufacturing process, the burn marks on the laser. Something that, to me, added something to it. So it was possible to get it out, and this is me literally inside it with a very wide angle camera. But it was very labor intensive. There's the virtual, 16 million facets, which take not even a minute to calculate, though not more in terms of trials and errors. But there is the physical, which was, 200 hours of laser cutting. Fortunately, we have three in parallel, so we could use it assembly, but it's a lot of work. It's very material intensive. It weighs 700 kilos, and the most hardware is heavier than wood. So there was a huge discontinuity between virtual and physical. This is, we nonetheless tried to push it a bit further. This was from the Guangzhou Design Biennale in 2011. And here the Milken actually out of ABS plastic on a much larger machine in China. And once again here when I showed this, so the idea was to move from an object to somehow a space that begins to surround with this ambition to take it to an architectural scale. And once again people spoke of these natural references. And the question is why do these natural references come up all the time? And why do people resort to natural metaphors to describe them? Is it because the processes really are so naturalistic? More and more, I think it relates to our history and our means of production since the Industrial Revolution. And in the sense that this mass fabrication favors relatively simple forms and a repetition of forms. It's difficult to, using standard machines, produce complex surfaces or something with a high resolution or multiple resolutions. And perhaps one could argue that therefore we come to associate the man-made with these mass-produced, mass-fabricated things, and everything that falls outside of this raster, in a way, we associate as natural. Go through Vienna, where you have very ornate facades and surfaces. Maybe that's not the case. In Zurich, where there's a lot of boxes, essentially, perhaps that's not the case. I'm not sure. Something I'm still struggling to understand. These are, so these columns, it's a bit of an illusion that at least I hope it will work for the first few seconds. It's only four of them, the rest is mirrors. And we designed them so that they look different from the front and the back, so each column is basically a hybrid of two columns. The hope being that if you enter the room, you initially think that there's more than four. It works for about a tenth of a millisecond before you quickly figure out that it was 10. But they do have, I think, multiple scales, complex curvatures, and lots of information. And perhaps they lend themselves less to reductionism, in the sense that it's difficult to deduce, perhaps, by which process they were designed. I would argue they do have an order. I mean, to me, if I look at them, it's possible to see that there is some sort of governing principle that's easy to distinguish from chaos, but nonetheless, the rules are difficult to deduce. I will skip over this. This was an attempt to going back to the earlier people as a result, to actually also fabricate it out of in slices, in layers of cardboard, and they failed miserably. Just because the material attribute, first of all, it doesn't work anymore once you bring it to formula by scale. But also the material attributes came into it too much. There were shear forces that took place. The cardboard board was ridiculously movie naive. We got about this far before we gave up. So it was a lesson learned that unless these fabrication constraints are really incorporated into the design process, it doesn't work. Effectively, one needs to model with this multi-distinction fabrication two distinct processes, one the design itself, and the second one the generation of fabrication data, or how to possibly get it out related to materials and machines or uses. But I think that's changing, because I think the second major development, and what I've shown in this first part of the lecture was primarily computational design, but now there's digital fabrication additive manufacturing. And we've been hearing much about this. I'm sorry, I'm going to be talking about it also, because I think we're really at a point where it's getting interesting. the two are coming together, and I think the two are predestined for each other in some way. And how is this going to influence design? Is the question. This idea of technology as one of the primary drivers, of course, something new, cast iron facades leading to Soho buildings or to Crystal Palaces. You had steel concrete rebar, which were made with free forms, bigger windows, high buildings, and so on. So what could this, the fusion of these two technologies be? We discovered how skillful this was. About a year and a half ago, a colleague of mine and I had a commission in Scotland, a museum in France, designed a grotto. His colleague was Benjamin Milberg. And it was for a show that's actually going on right now, Arculab in Oakland, in France. And it was, the commission for the grotto. From the outset, the curators wanted to portray a dialectic between man-made and natural, between foreign and interior, chaos and order. And we use the same process that I have shown earlier. And to come up with our first design, which you see right here. And I don't think this interplay between these two poles I described is particularly intrinsic to these processes, but the processes are conducive to it. So it was the idea of the room, it was the idea of the space that one could walk into. These were the very first sketches. Initially there were three sides, and at this point it's still all surfaces afterwards, but it was somehow converted to the bottoms. But the idea was a space that one could explore, so one with multiple scales, for instance, if you're 3 meters away you see something different than if you're running close to it, one that looks different according to different angles, so with a lot of folds and creases, so you could basically see hidden spaces as you walk into and walk around it. This is something that we're trying to promote. I had a fantasy to have it all in gold at one point, which unfortunately didn't materialize. And we, from the very outset, had a visualization problem, because the forms we were producing were no longer able to display. So it's very ironic that we were suddenly able to produce them, print them, which you'll see in a second, but we're no longer able to visualize them. So what you're seeing here is actually a much simplified version. This is how we imagine the surface quality and surface detail. Very much visual thinking for now. And the question came up, how to produce it. I mean, I've already said we referred to 3D printing, but initially we considered subtracting from milling. We went to the Carrara Mountains in Italy. And we were very surprised to see that in all these traditional workshops that we have there, you actually have the robot. A robot on a turntable, and it's milling away, and it's creating the exact same designs as hundreds of years ago. A man on a horse, or a man on a shield, or a building coming out of a seashell, or something like this. But it's all actually the machine thing right now. It's only the very, very last steps do men come in, or does the women come in, and it's going to... There's only a very... at a very late point, is there any manual effort involved anymore. It was interesting to see that the people are still producing the same forms. But we couldn't use it, unfortunately, because there were too many restrictions in terms of the mill going into the mill that would be too big, the mill would be too big to go into certain forms. We looked at different additive manufacturing technologies, and we're very happy to come up with one that is sand printing. This is a machine. It's massive, and it's a room basically. I mean, the board is full size. So it can print 4x2x1 meter at once, 12 ton pieces, and a 7th of a millimeter resolution. And it's by a German company, Voxeljet at Augsburg. But there are other companies that produce similar machines. But to us, it was an unseen combination of size and resolution. It has, up until very recently, been used primarily to make molding parts. So it's a form that one eventually put the metal into, cast the metal into, and then destroy the form of afterwards. But when voice process, the sound benefit, the sound transmission, has properties that are at least initially, we don't know much about that, if we've worked long term, are at least initially very similar to sound spot. So they can be used potentially, not potentially. This is the printing process that you're seeing, and it's very simple. It's just a layer, 1.3 millimeters, and it's placed across a bed. Then in the second step, it gets selectively moved in place. Here the head gets cleaned again, and this repeats over and over and over again. And the sound, the loose sound, the sound that's not blue, just gets removed at the end. It just gets vacuumed out. And in the best case, being reused. Places like one lifts the form of this smaller version of the picture. One, it's very much like an excavation. One lifts the form out of a huge bed of sand, and one removes the sand, and it slowly rises up. And you have to begin to clean it. It's currently a process that is still done manually, and it's very ironic that such a high tech process then requires so much work with the little vacuum, the air valve, to remove this. But the interesting thing is the machine does not care what it prints. Printing the most elaborate form conceivable costs as much as printing a single view. One is not by material use, but just by bounding blocks. And that's a radical change. Ornament is, of course, no longer a luxury. It's something that is no longer, because there's no cost check. There's no sacrifice to it. We've seen this already on the level of, I guess, 2D technology that allows us this freedom, but certainly not in 3D. There's not much three-dimensional content that is expensive up to now. It's been luxurious. But there's not only a differentiation within an object that's sometimes possible, but also between objects. So the machine doesn't care whether it prints the same form one time or highly individualized. There's no difference of cost, there's no economies of scale. Like this premise of industrial revolution is suddenly gone, evaporated. If you look around you, and you wonder why here you don't have it to the same extent as in Japan, but you wonder why there's so many standardized houses around. It's of course because it's more expensive to build individualized. But with this technology, and really it's not in the market interest well yet, you potentially have standardization, individualization at no cost as well. So we saw this machine, we returned full of optimism, and we became confident with the large plan for our auto. The idea was to entirely 3D print the room, not just the surface or skin, but also the actual structure, so the whole thing solidly. 16 square meters, 3.2 meters high. At that point, we had no idea how many it would become. And we would make it of large printed elements. How large? Well, we could have done the whole thing probably in 3 or 4 elements, but because the machine could do 8 cubic meters at once. But we actually got them by logistics. Too heavy to lift to handle parts that weigh so much, especially if you're just doing a small museum. A 12 metric ton piece is as much as 8 or 12 tons. These are details of the design, and it's a design very much in 3 dimensions, like the previous forms that show, no longer in time and section. And that in itself is probably a big change from how we think design is not traditional. There's no longer the need to bring it into that section, of course, because one essentially only needs to press the print button. So it's more a graphical approach, a sculptural approach to design than a graphical one. There's no need, unlike the columns, there's no need to adapt the form. to the materialization process, or to the material process. And you get a fusion of structure and surface, which is like different than the architecture you see around here, where you have the core springs, which are buried below, it's a nice articulated facade on top of it. It's arguably a bit like wood, which allows you to have, on the one hand, strength, but also an elaborate surface. It's easier to manipulate and faster. Here are other designs that we went through. Once again, this theme of the somewhere between the natural and the man-made, between chaos and order, or something that they're describing, for example, between expected and surprise. And we built a small prototype to test it here. And very much like the column ideas to bring, as I said, something that has a almost endless detail. So while we use design on the scale of bricks, we can now go down to some bits. Here is the prototype coming out of the printer. And here is a larger prototype, it's about 1.20 meters high. Out of infiltration, this is exactly how it comes out, just sound. We did some coding tests, and all failed. Sandstone was very highly absorbing of water, it's very porous. We had a hard time applying filler evenly. We tried this gilding process, which was by far too cumbersome also. There's just too many surfaces, quickly gave up. What we were looking at now was maybe 1/20th gilded and the rest is spray painted. And we started with real gold, moved on to fake gold, and then onto spray paint. All of them this man, perhaps a day or two. But the wish was done. I think eventually we'll be able to print more exciting materials than sound, so it's something I look to go back to. These are details of this 1/20th. So this is what I was speaking about earlier, that the idea that you are, the closer you get and the more you look into certain premises, the more you hopefully discover. And the answer for our coding was actually the Swiss mountains. After a number of tests failed, a person sitting next to me said, you know, it's so similar to sandstone, why don't you ask an old church conservation? And I did. I drove to a very remote valley in Switzerland, and this conservationist worked with restoring old sandstone churches. And what I thought was initially a translation error, because he spoke Anglo-Romanish, one of Switzerland's four languages, which I at least understand. He told me that we should use cheese, that we should use cheese to coat it. I thought clearly I'm not understanding something, but that is how traditionally these churches are painted with a mixture of lactose and cheese. And it worked surprisingly well. It actually covered it up very nicely. And it still sort of created a smooth surface. There's pigment or something also. Surprisingly, it didn't smell. And it had an astounding degree of resolution. The reason we couldn't use it in the end is it's also very expensive. So we had to resort to something closer to the simple alcohol. I will fast forward. This is just a detail on the brick. As I said, we could have got it probably in a few pieces, but we had to do more because of logistics. We were simply able to, in the scrolls that we printed, we hollowed them out. As you can see, we were able to use a sort of a Lego system. Into each other. Initially we thought, we don't know if it's going to hold, let's have some vertical shafts that we can pull this through. If it doesn't hold, then turn it out to be necessary. Here is the last block that we put on the paper. Once again, we were unable to render it, so the actual thing has more resolution. And here, if you bear with me for a second, is a movie of how the assembly took. lighting test from the engineering. This is the trial assembly. And it's a form that which I have practicing now because the display is so bad. But it's basically a form that is limited by a bound box, a single box on the outside, and passes itself through the skin of the box. So once again, there's a disconnect between the virtual and the physical, but the gap is closing. The printer had been working, I think, on the other project in under a week to print it, to bring the whole thing. The physical is, yes, it's the two parts together weigh 11 tons, which is much more than we expected, which presents a big problem for the museum, because it's even the floor loads and they had a special what's next? If one wants to use this technology for architecture to create something that's not just a small room, but something bigger, there's a lot of questions that need to be answered. We need a further evaluation of material properties, fire resistance, weather resistance, insulation, and longevity. In regards to structural performance, we wanted to have a roof over this thing, but we didn't dare to just because we didn't know about it, and the company didn't know either, because it only loses these things. The products on the roof had a lifespan of a couple of days before our company was made, so nobody knows at this point how it works. We need to improve the surface quality. Ceiling surfaces are a loss of information. Structural optimization, weight reduction, and the development of strong environment, I think, so it's no longer necessary to impregnate forms of resin afterwards. What is also nice? I think if we're using a process such as the one I described, we're dealing mostly with surfaces. We're not exploring the topological potential yet. The topological freedom, the amount of different skins we can have, the amount of porosity we can have. Perhaps we as architects right now lack, and there's processes which are better than others, I think I lack the tools to do so, and to get the full potential of this picture. And in one verse, we've got so much freedom, but what can we do with it? We have to find a culture for these possibilities. The technology is moving briskly, so there's printers that allow multiple materials, and that allow you to combine them, to control color, to control whether the form is hard or soft in places, to control whether you can see through it. And given the freedoms we have, I would argue that the computational design is one way that we can fully exploit that. I think it becomes difficult to otherwise design at the scale of seven points, which we are now able to effectively do. So I think it's going to lead to a wave of experiments, and some aren't going to be viable. Many are going to seem very naive. Yet, in some cases, the results of these experiments may be assimilated into standard architectural practice. Where are we? I've shown two projects. The first was possible through computational approach exclusively, the second one a combination of computational and additive manufacturing. I'll just repeat it because it's something I can't get my head around yet. But it doesn't matter what form one turns it, the cost is the same. There is no cost for complexity and no cost for individuality. Print spaces are getting bigger. They're working on bigger printers. prices are coming down. It's a new technology. There's less restrictions, more degrees of freedom. Right now, it's a time to play, to explore, to experiment, and I'm really curious to see what we're going to come up with. I'll leave you with a quote by Kahn. He said, this was in the architecture class in Pennsylvania some 40 years ago. He said, you say to a brick, what do you want brick? And the brick says to you, I like an arch. You say to the brick, arches are expensive. I can use a concrete neutral of it. What do you think of that brick? The brick says, I want to be an arch. The question before us is, what would a grain of sand like to become? And I will leave it at that point.